Welcome to Poptunative, where we dive into topical discussions from the worlds of pop culture, social media, and sports. Here is your host, Peter Remoliotis, a.k.a. PD Beats.
Hello, welcome to the Poptunative Podcast. It's the podcast where we have digital discussions, the worlds of social media, sports, pop culture, and hockey. Of course, we're very close to the 2018 NHL entry draft, and 104 players had the opportunity to go to Buffalo for the NHL Combine. And I'm talking to one of these, one of those players. We're talking to 67's player Carter Robertson. Carter, welcome to Poptunative.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
No problem. So yeah, how was the combine? How were the kind of the experiences? You know, how can you kind of describe how it was? Was it more overwhelming than exciting? Was it more exciting than anything? Was it a learning experience? What were the takeaways?
It was kind of all of it. Like, it depended on the player you were. Like, some players had way more interviews than different players. Like, some guys had six, some guys had 27. So some guys were busy at all times and kind of hectic. But, like, my schedule wasn't too bad. I kind of had a couple interviews each day, and, like, it was a good learning experience overall. Like, it was kind of cool. Like, there was people coming up to you when you went outside, coming to sign autographs. So that's kind of cool. New experience, different things. And then like, all the culture was good, too. Like, everyone's nice. Like, you feel like a pro already.
Oh, absolutely. Who is Carter Robertson on the ice, and who is Carter Robertson off the ice?
I'd say on the ice, just determined, like always wanting to win, doing whatever it'll take to win, block a shot, anything. And then off the ice, I'd say probably determined too, like doing anything to, become the best, no matter how much it takes.
Absolutely. And, talk a little bit about, you know, your year with the Ottawa 67s. I mean, this is, it's a young team. You're part of, I feel like, that young movement that the 67s tried to bring the last couple of years. Talk a little bit about your year and how you were able to grow as a player in Ottawa.
It kind of sucked at the start of the year. I got injured at the very start, but other than that, it was pretty good. Slow to get back into things, but our team was really good. We had a bunch of young guys. Everyone was good. They brought something to the table. We did better than everyone expected us to do, honestly. But overall, I thought me personally, I had a pretty good year. Got invited to the combine, so that's obviously I did something right. And then as a team, I thought we just really pushed, and we'll show teams next year that we're even better.
Now, how many interviews around would you say you had at the NHL combine?
I had around 8. There was 2 psych meetings that I had, so 6 meetings and then 2 psych meetings.
And were there some, I'm sure there was, you know, the general questions, but were there some questions that you were surprised about? Because we had Jack Perbix on the show, and he said that Washington asked him, they showed him a photo of a bus, and they asked him what direction the bus was going in or something. So did you have any interesting questions?
I had that exact same question, actually. I met with Washington, and at the end, like, the bus is literally the exact same on both ends, and the road is the same on both ends, and it's just, they asked you if it's going to go A or B. So honestly, I just kind of made up a guess and said why it was going that way. I ended up getting it right, but not why it was going that way.
Well,
so
Stanley Cup champions asking a brain buster there, right?
Yeah, exactly.
You mentioned a little bit. I'm really excited you mentioned that, because you mentioned, you know, the autographs and acting like a pro, and you guys are still young. I find that very interesting, because I think that, you know, you look at the OHL and you look at the players that play in it, and just the practices and just kind of like the everyday life and the big season and everything. It's funny because you guys are kids, but at the same time, you're kind of thrown in a situation where you have to act like a professional very early on.
Yeah, we have to act like a professional when we're 16 years old, if you get the chance. Like, you move away at such a young age, it's kind of tough, like, moving away from your family, everything like that. You got to get used to it, though, like, adjust real quick, or else you're not going to be able to fit in, basically. Like, and then everything with the combine, like, you're an adult. Like, everything they do, you have to be, like, sophisticated at all times. Like, you can't be fooling around. You got to, like, be on top of your game. Like, everyone's watching you.
You're like a role model, essentially, too. I see the 67s, the autographs after a game, win or loss. You got fans there waiting to meet you guys. Like, it's every game.
Oh, yeah. The kids, they don't, like, they care if you win or lose, of course, but they look up to you. Like, it's crazy how much you can have impact on a kid, and it's awesome to be able to do that. Like, it's so cool being a kid's role model.
Absolutely. You are technically a kid, too. So it's like a kid being a role model for a kid, kind of.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, absolutely. I find it interesting because a lot of people, when I ask this question, they'll be I get the, you know, I try to like be my own type of player. But were there any players, Carter, that you watched growing up that not necessarily model your game after, but you kind of like were kind of inspiration or influenced you in terms of the style of play you play?
Honestly, like my brother, I looked up to him at a young age, so. And his favorite player was Joe Sakic, so I kind of copied my brother, right? Like, I'd do everything he did. So as a kid, like, I looked at Joe Sakic, and he's not a defenseman, but he shows a great role in everything. Great captain on and off the ice. Like, he'd come, like, after every loss, like, we went and watched a couple games. He'd come and he signed our autograph one time, and it was just really cool.
No, absolutely. It's interesting, too, because... The game, like you mentioned, you know, you have to act as a professional at 16, but what I find interesting is what comes with that is you have a lot of players that even though you're growing, there are guys that have NHL size in the OHL already. There are guys that have an NHL shot in the OHL already. There are guys that have an NHL stride in the OHL. Just talk about the evolution of, like, on ice training. Like, it's just been amazing, and people are really working hard, and the skill has been amazing, and you know, you're getting people that are ready to go and having elements of their game that are pro at like 16-17 years old. It's pretty incredible.
That's crazy. Like, lots of kids hit puberty so fast, and you kind of see like the kids that hit puberty in minor bantam or something, you see them fall off really fast, and you see the kids that, like, example, like, I was always tall growing up, but I was always skinny, so like there's room for me to grow size-wise, but guys that are already men at 16, like, you kind of see them fall off, like, plateau kind of thing. But guys nowadays, like, everyone's skating and working on everything on ice and off ice. Like, it's crazy how hard you have to work to be able to just maintain.
But the thing is, too, I mean, you look at the league and you look at some of the players that have, like, got a chance to play in the NHL the last couple of years, and they're coming in, like, 18, 19 years old, and you know, even the players, like, I even feel like it's crazy when you have players that, like at a young age, like, that start the year off in the NHL team and play a few games, and like, it's almost like a shift in the guard, so to speak, where, you know, you have, it's like a younger game, and no spots, like, guaranteed anymore, because anything could happen, pretty much.
Well, even if you look at Vegas, like you said, no spots guaranteed. Like, every other NHL team will look at that now, and they'll be able to bring in guys and kind of just rely on guys. And, like, Vegas worked so hard this year, and that's basically what brought them to where they are. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a younger game, too. Like, you look at Victor Mete and Alex Formanton, like, they come into the league. They're both not huge guys, but they're so fast. Like, the game's changing.
Mm-hmm. So, I actually had... Noel Hoffmeyer and I had Austin Keating on the show around February, and I asked them some questions, and I don't know if you saw the episode. Did you see the episode?
No, I don't think I heard about it, but I didn't see it.
Okay, good, because if you saw the episode, then the segment can't work. But like, I asked them questions like, who in the 67s is like the on the phone most, who has the best laugh, who can eat, like those questions, and they told me who it is. So I want to ask you the questions, and I want to see if like the same people come up. I want to see if like there's a consensus. So who has the best laugh on the 67s?
Honestly, like, everyone's got their different style. Honestly, I'd say Hoff's got a pretty funny laugh.
Okay, and who is the loudest on the 67s?
Probably Hoff or Ty. No, Ty's probably the loudest.
Okay. Who is the most competitive off the ice? Like ping pong and video games, Fortnite. Like, who is the most competitive off the ice?
Our team's pretty competitive. Like, we had ping pong in playoffs, and like everyone was competing, like no one would let anyone win. Like it's pretty tough, like for that category. I'd say all of us are pretty, like, I don't know. I can't pick one for that one.
Well, they said Barron.
Yeah, that's a pretty good pick. He's pretty competitive.
And then, like, an interesting question where I feel like, so a glow stick, right? For a glow stick to glow, you have to, like, they're in the package, you crack it, and it glows. It's not going to crack right away. So I kind of use that as, you know, a player, right, who is basically maybe shy in the beginning or basically doesn't show as much personality, but then you kind of crack him like a glow stick and he becomes more comfortable and he glows, yeah. Right? Who is the glow stick on the 67s, in your opinion?
Quinn Ewell.
Really?
Yeah, he's a quiet guy, but once you get to know him, he's like, he's wild.
So
like,
funny
guy, but like, just, yeah.
They said Bitsy and they said Merrick Rippon too.
Yeah, those are two good picks too. I just think, like, Bitsy's always kind of been loud, so... At the same time, like, Bitsy would work for that one, but I think Euler's a good one just because I think he's still maybe in his glow stick, to be honest, but he's coming out of it.
For sure. I was kind of afraid when I asked that question because, like, it's like an interesting analogy, but, like, they got it and they understood what it meant, but I was like, okay,
yeah.
I'm going to go with, and then I asked, like, who eats the most, and they said it's Ball.
Yeah, oh, yeah, by far.
By far, I was like,
that kid eats like 8 meals a day.
What are some of the things that you, because everything is a learning experience, and you're at the stage now where you know you're gonna have to maybe make adjustments in your game. What are some things that you want to work on specifically to get kind of to the next level, Carter?
I think still doing my skating. I think lots of power skating throughout the summer and. Continue, like, I need to grow in size, so I think continue to work out and eat lots. Like, I think I got some tools in my game, but there's areas that I need to get better on, maybe physicality in my own end.
You kind of mentioned, you know, in the beginning, and I wanted to go back to it, about, you know, playing away from home, you know, living with a billet family and all of that. But, and then, you know, there's school, like, you're on the road, but there's also schooling that happens, you know what I mean? How do you balance all of that? It's so hard because you guys are pretty much, it's like a pro schedule. Like, you play, like, all the time, but you have to balance everything too, right?
Honestly, I think it's harder than a pro, like, schedule. It's pretty tough, especially with the guys in school, because you have to go from school early in the morning till later in the afternoon, straight to hockey, practice, and then work out. And then you still have homework on top of that when you get home. So your day's done at like 10 o'clock and you're just drained.
So do the teachers, like, they know you guys are on the 67s. Eh? Are you going to have that teacher be like, hey, you have a book assignment due. I don't care if you have to play North Bay tomorrow. Let's go.
No, they're not like that. There's some pretty chill teachers in our school, and that's why it's good. We went to a private school, and it worked out really well because they understood that how much we were on the road and stuff like that. So
now that. You're obviously, like, the private school you went to, like, people know you guys are on the 67s. Is that like, were there distractions there at all? Were, like, you know, people, like, you were more in, like, the public eye than other students type thing? Did that ever happen?
Yes and no. Like, kids would look at us and say, oh, they're on the 67s. But at the same time, we kind of just stick in our group. We wouldn't really, like, honestly socialize with other kids in the school. It's a pretty small school. Like, there's about 6 kids per class. And, like, so honestly, we just hang around each other.
Absolutely. Well, Carter, I think we'll wrap up, but thanks so much for coming on the show, man. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
No problem. Where can people follow you on social media?
Twitter, Instagram. My Instagram's Carter_Robertson27. Mm-hmm. And then Twitter is Carter_2.
Perfect. Well, thank you for coming on the show, and I wish you all the best come the NHL draft June 22nd, man.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate it.
For sure. Well, this has been Popternative. You can catch previous episodes of Popternative, youtube.com/Popternative for the video episodes. If you don't want to watch, you just want to listen, iTunes, Spotify, you can listen to the audio only. Until next time, this is Carter Robertson and PD Beats signing off.
Thank you for tuning in to Popternative. Make sure to check out our past episodes of Popternative on YouTube. Be sure to like Popternative on Facebook and follow us on Twitter.
This has been an Autograph Communications production.